And joining us on Hot Copy this morning, we have House Committee on Appropriations Chairperson, the Senior Vice Chair, Congresswoman Stella Kimbo. Congressman Steambo, Kimbo, good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, Karen. Thanks for having me.
All right. I wanted to ask you, the proposed budget for next year is 244 billion pesos than last year's budget. But overall, how would you describe on its face the budget?
Well, the executive calls it an agenda for prosperity budget. In other words, Karen, it's an economic recovery budget, which is the kind of budget that we are expecting today. So after 2 years of the pandemic and the numbers are falling, and at the same time, COVID is more or less better managed today, it's about time to shift our focus to economic recovery. And if you look at the agencies, the five agencies that has the biggest, that have the biggest increases, they all support economic recovery. Like, for example, the OTR has the biggest increase. Mm-hmm. And as you know, the reason for our huge contraction in GDP is really because of the lack of mobility. Yeah. So the new administration is making sure that in the next 6 years, there's going to be greater mobility, especially for our workers.
Okay, so let's start with the DOTR, since you mentioned it. The DOTR is asking for a 120% increase in its budget compared to 2022. They've enumerated all the projects, but the problem with the DOTR in the past is unspent funds, delayed spending, absorptive capacity. How are you seeing the DOTR implement these changes to actually make economic recovery, I guess, more successful when you think about it? Okay. Were you able to catch that, Congresswoman?
Well, I didn't get the latter part, but basically you're correct. Absorptive capacity is really a big issue for DOTR. In the past, it is really one of those agencies with the biggest underutilization rates. So, as you know, Karen, budget briefings will begin only on Friday. So That's the only time that the agencies will come to us. And that will definitely be a question to be asked by congressmen.
Okay. I'm curious, ma'am, will there be a change in how the budget will be spent? President Marcos Jr. said he wants it to be cash-based budgeting. This is what Ben Diokno had wanted, even in President Duterte's time. But then there was always for later release. How will the budget be spent this time?
So, Karen.
Okay, I have you back. Go on.
Yes, I am back. Yes, I caught the first part of the question. So you're asking about cash-based budgeting.
Yes.
It had been that way in the last couple of years. So it continues to be the same today. But what I'd like to mention an innovation that the House intends to do, which is to focus more attention to its oversight functions.
Uh-oh.
So as soon as we approve the budget, our work will not end. We will try to monitor budget execution. So we'll monitor releases, we'll monitor how agencies are able to absorb, and therefore we're able to make recommendations into the next round of budget hearings.
Okay.
So as early as March or April, DBM starts to collect budget proposals from agencies. So hopefully by then, we're able to sort of give initial recommendations on the rate of utilization of agencies.
All right, let's talk about the Agriculture Department. Given that the president himself is leading the Department of Agriculture and has said this is the priority, are you seeing that agri is really getting priority in terms of the budget?
Yes, in terms of the budget, yes. And of course, in terms of attention, the fact that the president is the secretary of DA, that's a very clear signal that agriculture is going to be a priority this time, which should really be the case.
Uh-oh.
Agriculture has been backward. It's a sector that is lagging behind all other economic sectors. It's really about time, no, that we need to improve the productive capacity of our farmers. The reason for why we continue to have food prices is simply because our food supply is not big enough, right? And so when it's not big enough, then that means our farmers are not as productive as we want them to be. And so, and if you look at the increases in the various programs of PA, it's really to augment programs to help the farmer improve its access to all kinds of inputs, as well as to markets. So land, for example, nandiyan yung support for titling of beneficiaries of agrarian reform. And then there's access to credit. And then there's like help for fertilizer, for seeds, for modern technology. So in other words, all of these obstacles being faced by farmers, from having too small farms because their land holdings are too small, to not having enough loans, as well as not having sufficient crop insurance. So if you look at all of these increases, it is in those very programs.
Okay. Offhand, are you seeing a big difference in the budget? It was something like 91 billion pesos for 2022, and the request of the DA in the past was 250 billion.
Well, the thing with very huge budget requests, there are two issues. One, of course, is absorptive capacity. We need to look at the historical utilization rates of an agency. So of course, DA is not really one of those top users of funds in previous years. Number two is, of course, sources of funds. As you know, the increase in budget is only 4.9%, which is a modest increase compared to previous years. So given that the budget is not the budget increase is not too big, you need to kind of like make sure that that's distributed across many sectors. And as you know, the president has an 8-point economic agenda.
But then there's going to be 30 billion for, I think, improvement on rice, right? I saw it on RG Cruz's report. So does this mean it will be an addition to the existing budget? Okay, Congresswoman, can you hear me?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so you were asking about the increase in the DA budget?
Yeah, only because there's a 30 billion peso that's been allotted to, for I think rice modernization or rice productivity improvement. Yes. So will that be an addition to the existing budget that was in 2022?
Yes, that's correct.
So do you have a figure, an estimate of just how much the DA will look like?
So that's a total of 102.1 billion. So this is for DA, including its attached agency. So you were referring to a 30.5 billion rice program, which includes an increase for the budget for NFA. So as you know, NFA is authorized to purchase rice for buffer stock. So just in case kulang ang supply of rice, which will tend to increase the price of rice, then we know that there's NFA there to augment supplies. So they increase the budget for NFA for that purpose.
Okay.
In addition, there's a 10 billion budget that is under the RCEF, or the Rice Competitiveness Enhancement Fund. So this is intended to improve, again, the productive capacity of farmers. So particularly funds for technology, for seeds, for mechanization, as well as, I believe, credit.
Okay. Now, I wanted to ask you, the rice tariffication law, when it was passed, the tariff that was collected, a portion of it, a large portion, was supposed to go for support to the farmers. How would you describe that? Was it successful?
you know, it was successful. So just the context first, Karen. The reason for why that was passed immediately was it was seen as a way to address the rising prices of rice.
Yeah.
And as you know, problema yon, pagbataas ng presyo ng bigas, because that constitutes a large share of total expenditures, malaki yung contribution nun to general inflation.
Yeah.
So that law was passed intending to bring in imported rice, which is much cheaper, mm-hmm. right? In which case, then the average price of rice would drop, which happened almost immediately after the law was passed. So in other words, the objective was met. But the downside when you increase imports is that it affects your domestic producers, particularly mm-hmm. when your domestic farmers are not as efficient mm-hmm. as their counterparts, for example, in Vietnam or Thailand.
I agree.
So that's the reason for why the 10 billion, meaning the tariff revenues
yeah.
that would come in, would be used for rice farmers. Ibabalik mm-hmm. din yun sa farmers para tulungan sila to become more efficient.
Uh-oh.
So that's sort of the philosophy. It's actually a nice philosophy.
Yeah.
No economist will argue with that. But the problem was that hindi mabilis yung disbursement nung yung nakuhang tariff revenues.
Yeah.
So it was by April bumaba na ang presyo ng rice, pero pagdating ng August hindi pa nila na di-disburse mm. yung tariff revenues. And mm. so may lag na ganun eh. So it's really in the implementation.
Uh-oh.
So hopefully because it's a president who says baka naman mas may fear factor, di ba, sa bureaucracy.
Yeah.
Baka mas mabilis, baka mas maging efficient ang ating bureaucracy.
Okay, so that's one problem, is the disbursement of the 10 billion pesos. But is it time to revisit the rice tariffication law?
Well, yes, because we need to check if indeed the farmers have improved their productive capacity. And of course, but I would venture to say it will really have to do with how quickly they're able to disburse and bring down technical assistance programs mm-hmm. for our rice farmers.
Okay. All right. Let's now move
to... And Karen, to, if ahead. I may add, smuggling then. We
yes.
have to check, di ba?
Yeah.
Kung baka naman dumami din ang smugglers, di ba? So kailangan bantayan din yun.
Okay. All right. Now, considering this is a budget that the target is for economic recovery, let's talk about health, education and health. Are you satisfied? Of course, education gets the biggest chunk of the budget, but have you seen an improvement in terms of priority for health? Under the World Health Organization, we should be spending a certain percentage when it comes to our GDP for health. And the Philippines has always lagged behind.
Well, of course, the pandemic is not over yet, Karen. So we need to make sure that our resources for health would be sufficient. So I'm glad that there's an increase in the budget for health. Remember, ang naging problema natin, Karen, is nung kasagsagan ng COVID cases, remember, nagkulang ang mga hospital beds in key areas.
Yeah.
So clearly, we still need to expand the capacity of our hospital sector. So there's an increase in funds for that purpose, meaning the HFEP or Health Facilities Enhancement Program. So that's good news. In addition, there continues to be a budget for our frontliners as well as vaccines.
Mm-hmm.
So at least, you know, nandiyan pa rin yung attention for pandemic response. But if there's maybe something that can be improved upon, I believe, Karen, is primary care.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to actually really focus more on primary care, meaning mm-hmm. prevention this time rather than curing, right?
Uh-oh.
Because that's always better. That's always more cost effective. And that's actually one of the two pillars of the universal healthcare law. The first mm-hmm. one being universal coverage for field health. The second is that every Filipino must be registered to a primary care provider, whether mm-hmm. public or private. In other words, dapat may doktor ang bawat Pinoy or a healthcare provider ang bawat mm-hmm. Pinoy. But today, clearly, we're very, very far from that situation. So primary care sana ang bigyan ng attention.
Okay, that's one thing. Now, the president in his sauna said he wanted to see specialty hospitals in different parts of the Philippines. I'm curious if that's already included in the budget for 2023, or would that be a private, would that be a public partner, public-private partnership? How is that going to be factored in with the budget?
Well, unfortunately, Karen, we don't have the details yet. So again, just to clarify, baka nakakonfuse sa mga nanonood, what we have on hand is the National Expenditure Program. Mm-hmm. It's the budget that is proposed by the executive to Congress. Hindi pa yan yung ina-approve ng Congress. Mm-hmm. And for us to approve that, we need to hear the detailed plans. So what we see right now are just numbers. We see an increase, for example, in the budget for health facilities in general, but exactly which facilities, then we need to ask the DOH. And that's going to happen beginning August 26, mm-hmm. all the way down to September 16. And it's only in September 21 that we begin plenary debates.
Okay, because what's interesting is when I interviewed the DOTR, a lot of the railway projects will not be finished during President Marcos's time. But frankly speaking, a specialty hospital can, right?
Yes.
Let's say a lung center in the Visayas, a kidney center, a heart center. So it's interesting to note if that's already included or part of the budget within the 6 years of this administration.
Yeah, so again, the details, abangan. But certainly
abangan.
That's going to be asked because every year, tinatanong talaga. So we need to get the details.
Okay. Now, with the priority of the president for specialty hospitals, it's quite interesting that there's been a slash, and I wanted to ask your opinion on this, with the budget of the UP system, which includes the PGH. So the original budget of $3.3 billion, based on that was submitted right now, is UP would suffer a funding reduction of $2.5 billion, while PGH would lose $893 million in the 2023 budget. Can you explain this, Congresswoman, exactly? Where did it go? Where did they move it?
Okay, so right now, if you compare what is proposed in the NEP compared to what they got in the GAA, which is the law that's actually signed by the president, you will see a drop. Okay, but if you compare what is proposed for 2023 compared to what is proposed for 2022, there's an increase of 4.7%. So it's really, yes. So, And again, Karen, hindi pa tapos ang budget deliberations. And historically, traditionally, maraming congressista, maraming legislators ang nagpropose talaga ng amendments on the PGH budget for whatever purpose. In other words, favorite siya na advocacy ng maraming legislators. Mm-hmm. Eh dapat naman, because syempre alam naman natin it's a premier hospital in the NCR. It's also a premier teaching hospital, right? And of course, for a teaching hospital to be really good, dapat yung hospital services program mo malawak din, right? Yeah. And so that's the reason for why typically during the period of amendments, maraming legislators ang nagpropose ng dagdag na budget sa PGH. So the fact that what is proposed today is higher than what was proposed last year is already positive, right? Ngayon, mahahabol ba natin yung what was approved last year?
Yes.
Palagay ko mahahabol because of what is normally done by legislators. So baka wag natin i-preempt. Balikan mo na lang kami, Karen, by October 1. Tingnan natin kung magagawa natin doon ang paraan.
Okay. Because for the benefit of our viewers, just to let them know, is the UP budget for 2022 was $25.6 billion. And based on what was submitted, it goes down to $23.1 billion. But I'm curious, Congresswoman, is it explained why? I mean, when you get these figures, do they explain at least why? Or where was the $2 billion transferred to?
So, okay, normally, again, this is really the job of the DBM, because remember, ha, yung numbers na to came from the executive, hindi ito galing sa Congress. So they should be the one explaining. Mm. But their normal explanation is that the first thing that they look at is the utilization rate.
Yeah.
So kung hindi mo nagamit ng 100% yung funds for whatever reason, and there continues to be obstacles in the absorption of those funds, then they will propose a lower budget, right? But then again, on the part of Congress, and that's the reason for why we do the budget hearings, we listen, we find out what will be the implication if we approve it as such, right? And so when we understand that the implications are going to be big, right, and not worth it, then we find ways to augment it. But remember, Karen, by the Constitution, we cannot change the ceiling, right? So if we propose an increase in the budget, for example, of UP, the UP system, magbabawas kami sa iba. So this is a dagdag bawas exercise. So it's not easy. Pag magdadagdag ka sa UP, saan natin kukunin yan? Kukunin ba yan sa ayuda? Kukunin ba yan sa farmers? Mm-mm. Kukunin ba yan sa senior citizen? So that's the balancing act. And that's the reason for why it takes time for Congress to deliberate on the budget.
Mm-mm. Okay, but there is a big possibility, you're saying, that UP will retain its 25.6 billion peso budget.
Yes, if, of course, past practices will carry through this year, there's a chance.
Okay, all right. The NTF-LCAC, quite controversial. And I think you can set the record straight, because some lawmakers say that while it appears on its face that the NTF-LCAC, the budget was reduced, it seems that the 10.5 billion pesos was now moved to the LGSF, which is the Assistance to Local Government Units, Local Government Support Fund, which means these are readily available funds. Apparently, the funds of the NTF-LCAC last year, a bulk of it was divided into two. There were unprogrammed funds, so it would have to be if it were available. So what does this mean, Congresswoman? Does the NTF-LCAC actually get an increase in a way?
So again, if you compare what is proposed compared to what was proposed last year by the executive, what is proposed this year is actually lower than what was proposed last year. It's a 64% reduction, just comparing the two NEP figures.
Yeah.
And then again, there's this complication, right? So whatever we approved in the GAA, it also depends on whether it's going to be put in programmed or unprogrammed, right? Mm-hmm. So what happened in the 2022 budget is that a bulk of it actually went to unprogrammed, meaning subject to fund availability.
Correct.
In other words, low priority.
Uh-oh.
So it's hard to say at this point, Karen, to be honest, kung ano ang magiging final na husga dito sa NTF-LCAC until we see the numbers. In fact, until it is signed into law. Kasi after we approve it October 1, it goes to the Senate. Senate will have its own version. For sure, magkakaroon ng bicam because the versions will be different. So we will have to meet, deliberate, etc. Hopefully, by the end of the year, that's the time that we will send it to the president. But of course, the president, as you know, will have line item veto powers. So it's only by January next year that we will really see what's going to happen to this fund.
Uh-oh. But just offhand, would you personally want to see more readily available funds given to the NTF-LCAC? Or would you prefer that it be just like 2022? Wherein low priority, kapag may extra pondo, di ibigay doon.
Well, sa akin, again, Karen, it really depends on how the program is implemented.
Yeah.
Because if you look at the objective, it's really to incentivize us to reduce the insurgency problem, right?
But remember, there was a hearing that the
guys that are cleared.
I was going to say, do you remember, Congresswoman, there was a hearing, I believe it was Senator Sunny Angara who discovered in the Senate that the NTF-LCAC wasn't able to actually finish the more than hundreds of projects that it had written, only 26 were finished at one point.
So again, that goes to my general statement that it really depends on how the program is implemented.
Yeah.
And then again, going back to the principle that you will get a reduction if you don't use your funds well. In short, if you don't execute your budget well, then you're sort of penalized the following year. So I think that general principle is sound. So yeah. I will not, whether whatever the program is, whether it's NTF-LCAC or maybe RISE Tarification Fund, etc., that principle stays. If we don't use our funds, mas maraming ahensya na mas magaling gumamit ng pondo. So, assuming na equally pressing yung problema mo, ilagay na lang natin doon sa kabila.
Oo. Okay. For 2023, are you seeing a lot of room for ayuda for economic recovery? I mean, I know the DOTR has 2.5 billion in fuel subsidies. There's a bill right now in the lower house asking for 10,000 peso ayuda for victims of natural calamities. What window are you seeing for ayuda, Congresswoman?
So, you know, this is just my observation. There continues to be ayuda in a sense of assistance, right?
Yeah.
So, nandiyan pa rin ang AIX, nandiyan pa rin ang TUPAD, etc. But in the case of TUPAD, there's a reduction.
Yeah.
There's a 40% reduction in TUPAD. But there's a like 145% increase for livelihood programs in, there's a particular program, no? In DOLE.
Yeah.
So, within DOLE, you'll see the shift in philosophy. Mas mababa yung ayuda for consumption, mas mataas ang ayuda for production.
In the
same way, if you look at the entire budget, ang laki ng ayuda for farmers. Ibig sabihin, yung dagdag assistance, that's also ayuda, Karen, right? Ayuda is a Spanish word for help, for assistance, right? But this time, the assistance tends to be more for production by small entities like farmers, etc. So for me, that's the shift. In the 2 years of the pandemic, we really needed to give ayuda to households. Kasi yung talaga, it's really hand to mouth eh.
Yeah.
Yung kailangan mo talagang i-subsidize ang mga pamilya para lang they will survive, right?
Mm-mm.
But today, as we have reopened our economy and we continue to do so, bumalik na ang ating mga estudyante sa face-to-face classes, etc., magpipick up na ang economic activity, dapat tulungan naman natin yung production side. So parang that's my, that's my appreciation of the 2023 proposed budget.
All right.
So, having said that, bottom line, nandyan pa rin ang traditional ayuda programs for peace, AIX, TUPAD, etc. But there seems to be slightly smaller allocation in some agencies.
Okay. Last two questions for you, ma'am. The budget may seem big in terms of the number, 5.3 trillion pesos, but nearly a third of the budget will be going to debt servicing. Kumbaga, pambayad natin ang utang ng interes. Is there any other way to go about this so that the funds can be used for services instead of debt servicing?
Let me clarify that, Karen. You know, when I saw that Inquirer, I almost had a heart attack. Parang, wow, one-third, that's alarming, right?
Yeah.
If you look at the numbers, it's only 11%. Only 11% of the budget will be set aside for debt service.
Mm-mm. Is it 1.2 trillion?
No, 582 billion, all right? Yung sinasabi kasi nila na 1.6, sinama nila yung principal payments. Principal payments do not require appropriation. In other words, yung 1 trillion na principal payments ay hindi po kakain dun sa 5.268 trillion. So, ninawi natin na that's an ocean of a difference. So, hindi one-third, hindi 33%, 11% lang po ang nakalaan for debt service. So in other words, kasi when you say 33%, it would mean displacement of many programs like ayuda, di ba?
Yeah.
So hindi po, it's 11%. Okay, going back to your second question, which is there any other way? Hindi talaga eh, because we will really run a deficit. And we've been running deficits naman eh, kahit na hindi, walang pandemic. That's really the philosophy behind pump priming an economy. You really need government to spend spend, especially in a downturn. Uh-oh. Okay, so the proposed revenues, sorry, the proposed disbursements or spending will be more than the revenues, and so ang pampuno talaga nun is loans.
Okay.
But it's that's sustainable. In fact, many agencies like the IMF, they've already said that the fiscal consolidation path of the Philippines is reasonable. In other words, in order for you to grow, you need to nurture the growth. Mm-mm. And one important way to nurture growth is to take out loans, because hindi mo kakayanin ngayon eh. Mm-mm. Hindi mo talaga kakayanin ngayon, but kailangan mong bumangon. So uutang ka muna, so long as you're able to use those loans productively, which is why we need to look at all the budget, all the planned programs. We make sure that whatever loans would come in would be put into productive programs.
Okay.
Para mabayaran mo din.
But then I wanted to catch what you said when you read that article. You nearly had a heart attack. Did you just say that?
Yes, did you just say that? I was like, oh my God. Yes, because we received the budget the day before, so it's about 6,000 pages, Karen.
Yeah.
But I knew that I saw the portion on debt, and I said, I didn't catch that. So that's a major problem if a third of your budget will just immediately go away. That's what it means.
Yes,
that's an automatic
exactly. That's why I asked
you. As soon as you get it, it goes away.
Yeah, but what you're saying on Head Start now, you are setting the record straight that is inaccurate. What actually goes to debt servicing of the 5.3 trillion is only
11%. 11.1.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. All right. That's straight right now. So, in other words, you're breathing with that particular figure.
Yes.
Okay. My last question is, how do we solve the main issues of the budget every year, which Congressman Ralph Recto pointed out, which is actually quite obvious even in the Senate before, is really spending delays and parking funds in PSDBM and the PITC. How do we solve that?
So this is the initiative of Chairman Saldico, our appropriations chair. He said, you know what, we have to work the whole year. Hindi naman pwedeng the appropriations committee will just receive the budget and then approve it, and then mag-vacation ka na from January up to August. Hindi, from January to August, ang gagawin naman natin is babantayan natin yung budget execution.
Yeah.
In other words, we need to make sure that the government agencies are on track in terms of spending. So by the time that they go back to DBM to propose their budget for next year, may recommendations na ang Congress. Pwede naming sabihin, you know what? Itong agency na to, parang wala pang ginagawa sa ngayon. So make sure that when you receive their proposal, keep that in mind.
Okay.
At least, mara-rationalize na nila yung debt for the following year. So that's a kind of innovation that, again, under Speaker Martin as well as Chairman Saldi, hopefully magawa namin this time.
All right. On that note, Congresswoman Stella Kimbo, thank you for joining me this morning. It's been quite informative. And I hope to speak with you again after the deliberations.